Today I will talk about basically how I created Hilfeleistung as service. This is a little side project I've been doing for the last couple of months, and I just want to give you basically an introduction how I went about to building this thing. So before I can basically let's start with the introduction. I'm Philipp Meyer. You can find me on Twitter if you like. I'm an IT consultant and software developer, although more software developer than IT consultant. Okay, what is Hilfeleistung as Service? First, I want to really translate it because it's kind of German, but it's also a really German problem. Basically, it's assistance as service. And what assistance as service is an online portal that makes it easier to request assistance with Deutsche Bahn, which is the railway company from Germany. And now something is pasting, great. So what are assistances? It's the next big question. I would like to show a picture, but I can't. Basically, assistances are stuff like when I want to travel with Deutsche Bahn, I basically have to request assistance with them, telling them, hey, I want to travel from A to B. And because many of their trains are not accessible, I need what's called a hoop lift. So an elevator, basically, a mobile elevator unit, with which they get me on the train level and then I can drive in. And that's basically what they call Hilfeleistung, those are the assistances. And they offer quite a lot of different assistances. The lift is one example, but they also have guidance for blind people and visually impaired. They can, if you're a wheelchair, if you can't walk really. And they do also, they do fancy stuff like reroute trains if an elevator is broken. So, for example, if the train normally arrives at track 1, but the elevator is broken at track 1, they can arrange that the train is actually arriving at a different track where the elevator is working. So, that are the assistances. And there are many ways with which you can actually request assistance. Basically, you can call them. There is an online chat. Funny enough, there's an online form, which will be a vital part later. And if you go to the counter, they either use phone or the online form. So the phone, there's much data you need to transmit, actually. So the phone usually takes about 15 minutes, because you have to say, okay, I'm a wheelchair user, this is a rigid wheelchair. No, I'm not 20 kilograms in weight. And then you have to tell them which train connection you're using, basically. One important thing, this is what it looks like. Like, it's not really necessary to know how this works, but this is what it looks like. It's an online application. This is Kai. Kai is very angry, and we will see why Kai is angry. And this is the lift, if you haven't seen it. You might have seen it already, there, standing at every major platform. Those are the assistances. Right, we were here. So phone takes a very long time, and you have a queue, which you have to wait. Then there's a lot of stuff you have to transmit. It's not like I'm buying my ticket and then like magically the data is available of the ticket I just bought. It's not the case. I've never tried the online chat, actually. No idea, but the data is always the same. It's always really, really much. So the online form is interesting, because the online form has actually 79 fields for a trip with a return ride and one transfer each. And just to give you an example, right, as I said, the shared problem of all these methods is the amount of data. And you would think that they somehow are able to transfer the data from the ticket, from the online ticket maybe you have bought, to their system, but no, you cannot. You have to type it in all again. And just to give you an idea what this looks like, this is the form. And just, this is not important what's in there, but just to give you an example of, if I scroll the right thing, of how long this form is. So we're almost done with the static part. Oh no, we're train rides, train rides, train rides. And don't forget, everything has been put in manually. There's no important nothing. You go which track, okay, Gleis 2. Which train number, and if you type it wrong, well, then it's just wrong. So you do this, and then the first transfer, and then the thing, and then the return ride, and so on, and so on, and so on. And at the end, you acknowledge their data privacy stuff. So let's go back here. Just to give you an example, if I'm talking about the form, I mean this thing. Okay, like I said, this has made some people very, very angry. In fact, it has made almost 90,000 people very angry. And Kai has started this petition, and he basically says this has to somehow be improved. This whole process must be improved. Like, the data is already there, just take the data, put it in here. It's basically, so, it's obvious requesting assistance must be improved. It really is obvious. So, my idea. I had this idea for a while. I'm a consultant, I might have to really commute to customers. This hasn't happened yet so far, because then I would have written this program sooner, but the idea is really easy. Why not make it better right now? You can't go into the Deutsche Bahn and make it better there, so you have to find some way from outside. And to do this, I basically said, okay, we need to be able to reuse static data. Yeah? Because many of the form data is actually quite static. So what is the wheelchair I'm using? What dimensions are there? Always the same. I don't have 20 wheelchairs. I use the one I have. And same for the name, for the telephone number, for what disability types I have. It's always the same. Then the next step would actually be to import rides, the train ride. Like, can't I just import it from somewhere? I have an online ticket. Can I just take something and put it in there? The third part is actually interesting. There are actually disabled people that have a Bahncard 100, which is the can drive any train any time. So we have disabled commuters, and they have to use this form, and they have for each, if they work 5 days a week, yep, no, the form. And then it would be nice if this solution would somehow track status updates. Because it's not like these things have status updates. So you have like you submit this form, and then they say, okay, I got it, and then they manually check if it is possible, and if it is possible, they will basically confirm it, and then it's like reserved, and then you're kind of okay, probably is okay, probably works. Well, most of the time it does. So it would be nice if this status would somehow be in this solution. And the building blocks are, of course, the form. So I must somehow integrate. There are no public APIs. There's nothing like an API I could call that creates assistance requests. But there is this online form, so maybe. And on the other hand, I must be able to process incoming emails for status updates. Because they're somehow always the same. It's not the edge cases, but there are a fixed number of emails that are automated, and you can parse them and extract the status from them. So that is the general idea. Now, the project scope. I have a large problem with motivation. and available time for that matter. Because if something takes too long, I kind of lose the interest, and then it's like, oh well. So I needed to get it done quickly. I needed to evaluate if this is even possible. And I wanted to collect feedback as early as possible. So I set myself a goal, 1 week. This thing has to be in MVP status within 1 week. So, how can I be so fast? Of course, serverless, what else? Serverless is actually pretty interesting, and in my opinion, serverless actually means less servers. So, use existing services instead of building it your own. So, for example, instead of implementing my own login, maybe I use Auth0 or if you must, Cognito. And that saves a lot of time. And it's funny because you buy other people's core domain as your supportive subdomain, which basically gives you all their knowledge and their leadership, but they sell this product, no? And you get it to use in your own application. So it's quite cool, and of course also Haskell and LixOS. It's funny how supportive Haskell was in this case, actually. What I also did is record a journal. So each day I wrote what I did on that day, meaning I could now create a talk based on that journal, which is really cool. And that's exactly what I did. So I will now basically go through day 1 to 7 and basically give a tour on what I did. On some parts I will get into more technical details, but let's start with day 1. The first thing to do when you're going serverless is to actually buy a server, obviously. So that's what I did. I ordered a virtual server and installed LixOS. It's actually quite alright, because the first thing is actually using Mailgun. And Mailgun is, as the name suggests, a service that shoots mails. So it's basically mass shooting of mails. However, there's a little something about Mailgun that's useful for me. You can also receive emails, and they have an API that lets you fetch those emails, and they do all the dirty work. They parse emails, they extract the attachments, all that stuff. It's already done. You have this API. It's a bit weird to use, but it's usable, and you get the email. So on the first day, I configured that. You can set callbacks and whatnot, and I also deployed a small Haskell servant backend on that server, and I was able to already receive emails programmatically. And so after the day 1, I was basically done with 2 of my goals. I have the proof of concept that I can process incoming emails. So on day 2, I kind of looked at an online form. And the online form is it's unfortunately a bit weird. So it seems to be some kind of .NET RPC framework they're using, and they have some weird data, like they send the HTML of that filled in form along with the request, along with everything else. It's like, I don't... And what is even worse, in my case, because I'm integrating with that form, they have client validation only. And what that means is basically that if they ever decided to change this form validation, I would not get feedback, because I would still making my requests and they would get wrong data and then they would be mad. So I thought, there was this thing, Selenium, something, something, maybe. And the first thing I looked at was Nightwatch.js. Maybe some of you know it. It's basically, if you want to test user interfaces in the browser, you can use Nightwatch.js, which uses, again, a Selenium server, which is basically a browser. And then you can programmatically tell this browser to do things like fill in forms and submit it. That unfortunately didn't work because it's too tight to test cases. So there, it wasn't possible to boot it up and just say do things. They had to be in a test. And so I went on and I found WebDriver Arrow, which is the same thing, but it can be ran outside of tests. So I could programmatically control a browser and, of course, fill out a form. And one day, too, I had a proof of concept that I'm able to fill out this form and submit it. It's actually really cool, and it can also make screenshots, which is nice because then I have proof of what I've sent them. So that was day two. And at that point, I knew it was possible. At that point, I had these two things that were somehow uncertain, and all the other stuff I knew I could do at this point. So this is where I will get a bit more technical, because this is actually interesting. I had to somehow get this form into Haskell, and how do you represent data in Haskell? You have an algebraic data type for them. And that's what I did. This is a particular example that's a bit more evolved. When you want to give information about your disability and the type of aid you're using, you basically have this form, and it says you can be blind or not, and then you can be additionally either have a walking disability or you're a wheelchair user, or you can have another disability and you can like write text what your disability is. And this is basically the handicap. And you can see I tried to put as many, I tried to really express this form with all its structure in the ADT, so that basically I can avoid invalid states. So the idea is that the walking disability, you can see it's maybe 8 walking disability, because you can actually uncheck it, and then you have no walking disability. But if you do, you can either you have a walking disability or you're a wheelchair user, and then depending on that, you have different aids to choose from. And that is this part. And that's basically the example for wheelchair user. You can see that you have these options, okay, but also the dimensions are optional based on what you choose. And that's encoded here. If you can see, the first 4 are maybe dimensions, so you can give it if you want. But if you have an electronic wheelchair, you must. And that is encoded here, and basically invalid states are not possible, or almost not possible. If you look here, if you have nothing, 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 that's of course invalid, but you have to stop somewhere. So, this is the form in all its glory. Doesn't look so big. And then you can do fun stuff like deriving all the things. And I really use this. This is production code. Because at some point you need to persist all of this, and there's this hipster database. I don't know if you know it. That has really good support for JSON. It's called PostgreSQL. I can highly recommend that database. And it really can work well with JSON. And there's one more thing that was really interesting. And you can derive arbitrary. So not only did I have this form on day 3, I could really arbitrarily generate them. I didn't use it in any tests, but I could generate test data basically to just quickly get something out of this. And that's important in the next step because there is a morphism missing right now. And that is the form ADT. to the actual HTML form. So I need something that I can give my Selenium WebDriver IO microservice, so that this service can actually execute this this thing, and I called it the submit job. And that's basically just a JSON representation. If you look carefully, the names are Vorname, Email, Mobilnummer. Mm-hmm. So they are already translated. The morphism translates this into the actual form. Like here, the name is Vorname. I don't know why they do it in German, but that's how it is. So with that morphism in place, I had a service that could actually execute an instance of this ADT form and really submit it. That's called submit job. And that's what I did on day three. And now the fun part happens, because now the question is, how do I get an instance of form? But we still have to optimize a bit of stuff. We have to extract the static data, and we have to extract the dynamic data of this form, and somehow optimize this. And that's basically what I did. General data is everything static. So you set it once in your profile and you're done. You always have your static data. And the thing that really varies is the train ride. So with the static data out of the way, we can now focus on the train ride and make creating train rides more easier. We can import train rides, all that fun stuff. So, I lied, I wasn't done at day 7, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But day 4 to 8, I basically worked out the back end, persist general data, persist train rides, define those things, extended the servant API. I made registration and login with Auth0, which is user management service. And I basically wrote a single page application with Vue and Vueify, which is then basically using the servant REST API. And on day 9, I finished connecting those two parts. So on day 9, I had general data, I could register, could fill out a profile, I could plan a ride, a train ride in the application, and I could issue an assistance request. That was all. Day 9, I was done. Day 9, this MVP was in production, and I had the first person to actually test this and issue a really valid request. Because you must imagine, I can't just test that. Because each time I submit this, I have to somehow explain on the phone that that's just a test and I'm building stuff. And actually happened twice. But yeah, that's another story. It's funny because they have a function in their form that's called validate form. And guess what?
It sends a form.
It sends the form if it's valid. Of course. Yes, that was funny. So, result and learnings. I'm really quite fast. It's good. It's good. I think we're in time. Result and learnings. This thing has now over 60 users. There are some test users. There are quite a few active users. They're mostly the commuters, because they have an option to repeat train rides. Getting feedback early is really, really, really important. Like, on day 9, I was basically already too late. Because on day 9, on the first submission, I got emails that I've never seen before. Like, he got some online ticket with reservations. I'm like, you can have that? Weird, really weird. And actually, the first feedback was where is the improvement? So at that point, you couldn't really do much. At that point, I have reduced the 79 fields to about 34, but you had to still input it manually. In the meantime, I have implemented a function that lets you import online tickets. So you have the Auftragsnummers, or the reference of the online ticket, the six digits, and then you click on one button and you have your ride import, and you click on request assistance and you're done. Assuming you get the assistance. But now, what's also interesting, apparently it's not a problem, like I fixed the wrong problem. Because I have 60 users, I was expecting around 2,000. I have to add that Kai made an update on his petition, so you can say that around 20,000 people got an update that this thing exists, and yet I have 60 users. So something isn't right. I have not hit a sweet spot. And that's because it really isn't a problem. If you're traveling two times a year with Deutsche Bahn, you can easily fill out this online form. That's not the problem. So I think it's failed. I think it really, in that regard, it really failed. But funny enough, it was really, really successful in a way I have not imagined. And let me introduce you to this guy. This is Bernd Koch. He is the Vorstandsvorsitzende. He is CEO of Station and Service. Station and Service operates all train stations in Germany. And they're also the one that carry out, they're executing the assistance requests or the assistances. And he invited me to Berlin a month ago and said, hey, show me this thing you built. And so I showed him, and I said, so what is Hilfeleistung as Service? What is Assistance as Service? It's a vision. It's a vision that someday in the near future, disabled people might be able to travel spontaneously with Deutsche Bahn. This is not possible today. You have to make the request at least one day before. They cannot handle it otherwise. If I would go to the train station right now, they would reject me. They could not transport me anywhere. And if we optimize the process that is highly manual at right now, if we are able to optimize, digitalize this process, we might be there someday. And with that, I'm actually done after 25 minutes, but I think it's okay. Worked out perfectly. So, thanks. And Pascal in production, yay!
Yeah, thank you very, very much. And let's talk about the questions.
Yes, please. Okay.
Oh, could have most of it been done actually just as a browser extension or something? Or just pre-fill in the browser? Doesn't it automatically remember?
Not in this case. I thought about using a browser extension actually, but it was like when I was halfway done with the thing. So,
and you can't get the emails, I guess, easily?
Yes. The system right now actually does a little bit more because you have this assistance request as a thing, and it actually adds the emails to that. So basically, you only have the emails for that assistance request grouped with your assistance request. So if you're traveling with 5 days a week, you get like 3 per ride. So if you're 6 per day and then 6 for 5, you could 30 emails, at least 30 emails, which is, you cannot organize that. So this is something I can do because I have an online program. And then there's fun stuff like importing online tickets. You cannot do that. Maybe you can.
Are you scraping that actually, or how do you get something?
There is an API that the DB Navigator app uses. So it's an unofficial API, and you send them some JSON, some XML, and then they send you some XML back, but say it's HTML.
Okay.
Really brilliant API design, but this way you can get the information. Unfortunately, only for online tickets. So if you buy and at the counter, you get a different number, and that doesn't work. I don't know. That's barn, I guess.
So maybe a remark on that. So there used to be a service called MailBuddy in Germany that would automate filling out the form for delayed trains.
Yes.
Right? And that would parse your PDF, and I happen to know it's written in Haskell.
Okay.
So I could set you up with that person.
Like I said, the actual problem isn't that, and yeah, I forgot. Have I mentioned that they are actually booking me through my company so that I can analyze their process? I may have forgotten that little part. So no, I have the chance to actually fix their process. So I have the chance to implement this because of this MVP. So, yay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Koch. I will probably start it next month.
Are you still going to use Haskell? Will they accept?
Probably not.
Oh.
I don't know. Probably not. It's like there have to be people that maintain the software afterwards, and then it's like, hey, it's Haskell. We only have Java persons. I don't know. But I will try.
Did you have to learn any new library in Haskell, or you knew all of them like Servant perfectly, Postgres, whatever library you were using? You knew you had all that knowledge.
Yeah. I had to do a little bit of stuff with the authentication because it's OpenID Connect. So I had to somehow get that into Servant, which sometimes required using this raw thing handler. Of course, I also wasted a bunch of time with trying to monetize this. So I had set up Stripe, I had working PayPal integration, I had, at some point, you could basically, for 1 euro, you could have one request, but like the day before, I just cut it all out and said, okay, donations only, and that was the right move. But no. Like on day three, I knew what to do. It was done. I also knew how to parse stuff. And any more questions? I guess we're done. Thank you.